by Cowles.
You're getting your man, you're stopping.
Well, where did you get that?
Therefore, I would like that item added after executive session, which would be literally just for purposes of adding to the agenda, an agreement to be discussed in executive session. I will need a motion to vote on that. And Mr. Chairman, you have historically recused. You don't know, none of y'all know the subject matter, but I do. And I would ask, Mr. Chairman, that you refuse from this vote to add to the agenda. It will take unanimous vote if the chairman refuses.
I'll be able to keep myself of Agree, whatever. Vice Chair, will you take care of it?
Do we have a motion?
Make a motion that we put an item on the agenda, first of all, that we will be coming out after executive session with some sort of announcement or agreement.
Yes.
And that's my motion.
Second?
Second.
Please vote. The vote is 4-0 with Chairman Amos recusing.
Thank you, Board.
Got all, Counselor?
That's it, Mr. Chairman.
No 47 combinations in that?
Not that 47 combination.
The motion, yeah.
Where did that item come from?
Like, after come out of second session. It's all on that. The motion to adopt the agenda as amended.
Second.
Motion second to adopt, please vote. Motion carries. Item four, under announcements of the court, I believe we have a proclamation by the Board of Commissioners to the Optimism Club. We have two of them here tonight. Y'all will come forward and gather around the podium. We'll read this. We have one for each club. Clap, come in. I'll read it out to you. We'll break out the attention. Thank y'all. I really didn't know we had two clubs. As long as I know what club, I didn't know we had two. Thank y'all. Whereas the purpose of the Optimist Club is to help develop optimism as a philosophy of life in our youth by promoting an active interest in good government and civic affairs, inspiring respect for law, promoting patriotism, and working for international accord and friendship among all people, and aiding and encouraging the development of youth in the belief that giving of oneself and service to others will advance the well-being of humankind, community life, and the world. And whereas Forsyth County and Summit County Optimist Clubs provide an avenue for the local community to offer programs specifically designed for children. And whereas the annual essay and oratorical contest, junior golf tournament, track and field day are hosted by the Optimist Clubs each year in Forsyth County. And whereas the Forsyth County Optimist Club feels that providing the best charitable service organization in the community will help further the goals of Forsyth County. Now, therefore, it be resolved that the Board of Commissioners in Forsyth County recognizes the efforts of Forsyth County, Summit County, Optimist Club, and they are hereby proclaimed January 15th today as Forsyth County Day Optimism in Forsyth County, Georgia, so that all citizens would take a moment to think about how they can help the youth of this community. In testimony whereof, we have here unto affixed the seal of the County of Forsyth, State of Georgia, the Secretaries of the members of the governing body there on this 15th day of January 2015. Thank y'all. Yeah.
That would be standing here.
Might be easier. Now we have one of each here with you.
Jim Yarler, President of the Morning Club, and Randy O'Dell, President of our.
Good. Shall we gather around and face out that way and log in with some pictures of them?
I'll just make sure everyone can see me.
Sure, don't rock you out where else.
Tall man goes in the back.
I'm the short guy.
How's it look, Logan?
Okay, I can see everybody. Oh, that's good. That's good. Perfect.
Thank you. Logan, you're on the spot here tonight. Can you explain our rules and meetings?
Yes, sir. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents for the commissioners, please provide a minimum of 7 copies and submit those to the clerk when approaching the podium to speak. 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they signed up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. Mr. Chairman, we have 4 public comment speakers this evening. Our first speaker is Jennifer Cattle.
Good evening, and thank you for your time. I am here to speak on behalf of my community. I am the executive director at Montessori Academy at Sharon Springs, and I am speaking in opposition to the zoning restriction ZA or amendment ZA3258. As part of our community, when the center was being sold, we were told it was going to be a school, and then we were told it was going to be a state and fitness center. So looking at those, making amendments, and being able to keep our children able to use the green space that was there. They were in the fields, they used the facilities, they were their PE teachers. We had a great relationship. And when we heard that it was going to be a storage facility, we immediately took that information to our parents, and our parents responded in droves. So in less than 12 hours, we received 50 emails, and I think that Mr. Tan has also received emails from our families. They're worried about the security of the items and the contents in there. Our children are from 18 months to 15 years, and so not knowing what's in there. And I would love to think that we live in a society where we can know that our children are safe, but we've been highlighted in the national news on things that we thought would never happen here in Cumming. So as their representative, I feel very compelled to speak that you do not lift that restriction, because once that's up, we lose the ability to say how high the buildings are going to be, how many buildings are going to be in there, within those storage units, what's going to be stored in there. And I ask you to take that into consideration when you are considering the fact that we have children as young as 18 months, all the way through 15 years, and their safety is our utmost priority, and I hope that it's yours as well. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Our next speaker is Jack Gleason.
Greetings, Council. It'll be my first address to the Council this year. Happy New Year. My commissioner came and attended a smart group meeting. My name is Jack Gleason, by the way. I live in South Forsyth, Christopher Robin community, and I'm a member of Smart Growth. We had our elections last night. I'm optimistic to tell you that went well. Everybody's still on the board. There were a couple of little shuffles, and we got some great news from our commissioner about new changes and reviews going on, the comprehensive plan. I'm optimistic that we'll get an opportunity to square some of that away. It's my understanding the tree ordinance is being discussed. I'm optimistic that we'll have an opportunity to get the tree ordinance right, because the character and the beauty of Forsyth County is definitely in the tree. It's the first thing we see fall when too much development goes down. So that said, I wanted to wish you a happy, optimistic day and a growth-motivated future, and thank you for the opportunity to speak before the board today.
Thank you, Mr. Gleason. It's only our second meeting today.
Sir?
It's only our second meeting. You said speak to us the first time.
You know, I forgot.
Our next speaker is Bill Pittman.
Good afternoon. My name is Bill Pippen, and I live in Forsyth County at 6935 Kettering Lane, Swanee. Let me start off by saying thank you for the job you're doing for the county. It is a wonderful place to live. I am here to request that you do not approve Amendment AZ140055 for the property known as the Hit Center, located at 2850 Old Atlantis Road. Amendment AZ140055 requests Condition 13 be eliminated. No single tenant or individual establishment may exceed 15,000 square feet. Considering the location of South Forsyth Middle School, Sharon Montessori School, Sharon Forks Public Library, and the surrounding subdivision, the Forsyth Board of Commissioners made the right decision to include Condition 13 in the original amendment ZA3258 with the current owner. Condition 13 ensures the balance of a quality of life and economic growth for the local community. I'm opposed to AZ140055 for the following reasons. First, I need to understand the investor's intentions for the property. In the first public hearing held on Thursday, January the 8th, the investor maintained that two additional buildings were going to be built. In the documents that were submitted to the county, it shows multiple mini storage buildings. I need clarification. Two, if Condition 13 is removed, the investors can do what they want with the property at will. That can include multiple five-story storage buildings with unlimited square footage. I do not believe that is in the best interest of the community. Three, mini storage units are governed by UDC 16-4.20 that maintains no individual mini warehouse building shall be more than 200 feet long. Does the existing building on the property meet this criteria? I would like that to be included in the investor's plan of record. If it does not, I would submit that an amendment would need to be filed with the Forsyth Planning Department and a public hearing would need to be held. Four, though the property is zoned for storage units and mini storage units have a proven reputation of increased crime and drug activities. Just Google self-storage, drug activity, and crime. I have safety and security concerns for the surrounding areas that include Sharon Montessori School, the South Forsyth Middle School, and the Sharon Folks Public Library. My youngest child will be attending South Forsyth Middle. Five.
Mr. Pitt, how much longer do you need?
Just one more paragraph.
Okay. All right. Go ahead, sir.
Five, is this the best use for the property? I say not. There are at least 28 storage facilities within a 20-mile radius of the current property. In conclusion, I'm requesting that the Forsyth Board of Commissions do not approve zoning amendment AZ140055. That requests the elimination of Condition 13. No single tenant or individual establishment may exceed 15,000 square feet. Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Mr. Chairman, that was our final speaker.
Thank you, Logan. Item 6, the adoption of the minutes. I hear a motion to adopt the minutes of regular meeting, public hearings, and executive session of January 8, 2015. Motion second to adopt. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. The motion to adopt the consent agenda.
So moved. Perfect.
Second to adopt, please vote. Motion carries 5-0. On the old business, item 1A has been, old business has been postponed until February 5th, 2015. Item 2, Director Parker, Jeff. State your name.
Jim Breyer, Director of Parks and Recreation. Good evening. When you last met on December the 4th, you had a public meeting with citizens that were coming out talking about the operations at Fowler Park Tennis. Our contractor announced they were leaving as of December, and that kind of made the decision a little bit easier for us. And at that time, you versed us with looking at operations and seeing what kind of proposals we could come up with. And looking at the situation objectively, we have 36 tennis courts throughout our county, 12 of which reside at Ballard Park. And I thought that the best operation device would be to unify our operations, do things on a uniform basis throughout the county with all 36 facilities. So Parks and Recreation has come up with a plan that we would like to propose to you tonight. This plan was presented to the Parks and Recreation Board and unanimously approved for recommendation by them. I have Jim Brennan, our recreation manager, tonight. He did such a good job presenting that the Parks and Recreation Board was real efficient. I said, hey, can you come do that again to the commissioners? So I'm going to have him present, then we'll be here to answer questions should you have any.
It's because he has that radio voice.
Good evening, Jim Brennan, recreation manager. Our proposal that we took to the board last week was simply that all 12 courts at Ballard Park would come back under our control. We would handle all tournaments that were held there, all youth and adult leagues that were put on there. We would also work with the high schools when they need court space for matches. The court space will now be free of charge if you walk up and the courts were empty. Prior to that, under the management company, that wasn't the case. And we also have an opportunity to rent court space. If you and a friend want to go out and play on Saturday and you want to be guaranteed a court, you can go online or you can contact our office. We can let you, the reservation schedule and everything is online, or we can give it to you at the office and you can reserve court space there. As far as instruction, we don't have in-house on staff any tennis pros. So we will, what we do at all of our other courts is that we do a private contractor. They sign a contract with us, we pay them a percentage of what the cost is, we take care of the registration, the marketing, we'll give them a roster prior to the program beginning, they'll run their program, and then we pay them. The pricing for what we charge for lessons will be consistent at Fowler as well as our other courts. And the level will be the same as well. We told our instructors that we want to offer both youth and adult lessons. We want to offer youth and adult drills and practices and those type of things. So as Mr. Pryor was saying, we just want to kind of make our whole tennis program countywide consistent.
Thank you, sir.
I have a question. On the clubhouse that's there, what is it going to be used for?
It will probably, for right now, just be used for storage. We can open it up whenever we have like a league going on or maybe a tournament, because it is air conditioned, so we might throw a little furniture in there. But we won't have a pro shop.
Could you use it for rentals, for people that want to have a party or a tennis party, and they rent the clubhouse too for refreshments and things?
We could do that. It's not very big.
It's air conditioned on the outside.
Well, right. But yeah, you're right. You could set up a couple of tables in there and put refreshments and things if they were, you know, having a match.
A tennis party or something for kids or adults.
Yes.
It would be nice if it could be used for something.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. Instead of just being used for storage, if you could have an offer to rent it out for adults or children or something along that line, something.
How far in advance will you be able to make reservations for the tennis?
Yeah, I believe you can go online, and if anything, if you click on the schedule, it'll show you when the courts are open, and you can set up an account, and you can just click right immediately and say, I'd like to reserve this for, you know, tomorrow.
There is a fee for the reservations.
So. That's correct.
And that fee is non-refundable if you don't show up at what point, or non-refundable period.
Well, I mean, we try to work with everyone. If Jim and I decided we wanted to go play tennis next Saturday and we went ahead and reserved the court, but we saw that there's a storm coming in and, you know, and we weren't going to be able to play, the Parks and Recreation Department works with folks among those type of things.
I'm just trying to anticipate the emails we might hear and see. So next, let's say somebody makes a reservation just a week out, which is responsible, you know what your week's going to bring, and they just don't show up, it's a beautiful day. That'll be one incident. At what point past the hour, is somebody allowed to start using that cord and they forfeit?
Well, if someone came on to just walked up and the courts are empty, of course, those are free of charge. If there was a rental for a particular court and the renters did not show up, then it would be open for anybody else to step out there and use. But technically, they'll have the receipt that shows that they did pay for an hour. So if they rented from 1 p.m. to 2 p.m. and they showed up at 1:30 p.m., they still have the rights to the court for that next half hour.
Very good. That's what I was going to ask, because you'll find that some people that walk up, see nobody playing, and 5 minutes after, they'll start to play. I didn't know how that would be a priority. That explains it.
Right. And the schedule is also posted for all of our leagues and lessons and our team reservations and all that. That's actually posted on the kiosks there at the court. So when you walk up, you know, to play, you might see 4 open courts, but you could also look over to make sure that those courts don't have anything scheduled on them nearby.
Perfect. Just keep the conflict down out there.
Correct.
Well, one thing we didn't address was revenue. Of course, with the private company, they paid us a monthly stipend. I believe with the uniform operations and the popularity of tennis and the programs that we offer out there, I believe that we can recoup the revenue that we lost with Annika, if not possibly gain more with our program. And at Fowler Park, with having 12 courts, we can plan lessons or team play on 4 or 8 of them, but always keep at least 4 of them open for free play and community play. So I believe it's a good proposal, bringing it back in-house. I think we could operate it very efficiently.
Thanks, Sean.
Thank you.
Counselor, do we need a motion on this? There's no, it seems we don't have a totally written plan, or do we just turn this over to our park rec department?
Mr. Chairman, I don't believe there's any formal action by the board required.
Okay.
At present time.
It just said staff recommend approval. I want to make sure, so there's no formal action needed. Thank you, Jim. Thank y'all. I'll turn it over to you. Item 3 has been postponed February 5th, correct? Commissioner Campbell?
That's correct.
Item 4. Mr. Brown.
AZ140058. This is located in Commission District Number 2. This is a decision for Edwell Heights LLC regarding the deletion of zoning conditions number 13 and number 18 placed on zoning application 3354. The public hearing was held on January 8th, 2015.
This is decision only. If the public hearing was held earlier on January 8th, Commissioner Tam, I believe this is your district. This condition is approved.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Before I make a motion, I have something that I would like to read that I'd like entered into the record. With respect to AZ140058, I would propose the following. Before I make a motion this evening, I want to state a few things for the record. I am aware that this request for zoning condition amendment is for a piece of property directly adjacent to property where this board recently denied a request to change conditions. In July of 2014, the Board of Commissioners denied AZ140021, which was a request for a property directly south of this property to modify zoning conditions such that the existing open space requirement was removed and to allow development to occur without a required 50-foot graded buffer and berm. The plan accompanying AZ140021 revealed that this property would be developed as an automobile service establishment. AZ140021 was denied, and I continue to believe that was the right decision. The matter is in litigation, and therefore I will comment no further other than to say the present request to change conditions for AZ140058 is altogether different. The main change being requested is to allow greater square footage for the commercial buildings. However,
The proposed use for this property is for a self-service, self-storage facility. In this commissioner's view, a self-storage facility is markedly different than an automobile service establishment, both in terms of intensity and potential impact to neighboring communities. The Unified Development Code, UDC, authorizes me to consider the proposed use on a property when making a zoning decision. And in doing so, I am comfortable that approving this condition amendment is consistent with the zoning code. I also want the record to reflect that in making a motion to approve AZ140058, it is not my intent that any precedent be established justifying more intense commercial uses on nearby or adjacent properties. My motion is based upon the particular proposed use of this property combined with the agreed upon conditions and otherwise serve to lessen still the impact the proposed use will have on nearby properties. With that having been placed on the record, I hereby make a motion that the board approve AZ140058 with the conditions as displayed on the screen this evening.
Second for discussion.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. John Knorr, I didn't catch which one, but one of the conditions talks about a berm with a 1-2 slope. I thought somewhere we had decided that slopes had to be 1-3, a 3-1, I should say. Can you comment on that?
That depends on whether it's a cut or fill slope. I assume the construction of the berm would be filled, so that could be the case. They could have to structurally stabilize it.
Condition 27 is.
If that's the case, it would be addressed during the design.
And then, if I followed the bouncing ball correctly at the earlier comments, there's an issue about or concern about the building being five-story or something.
And the comments earlier were on the self-serve storage facility that I postponed until February 5.
Okay.
So there were no comments tonight on this particular item.
Now, is this the zoning, though, that we kept getting emails asking us not to delete number 13? And if so, what is number 13? It's not on here, and I don't know what it is we're deleting.
I think we can go.
I didn't see it in the notebook.
No, that's the one you.
Okay. What we did was we removed condition 13, and we replaced it with.
Number 18.
Yeah, well, I'm going to get to that. Yeah, but we did remove condition 13.
I thought 13 was on the placement.
Yeah, right here is remove condition 13.
Okay.
So we did remove that. However, we did replace that with, and you'll have to scroll down. Condition 13 spoke to architectural landscape standards, and it came in as a product of this zoning being done during the time we were coming up with the Peachtree Parkway overlay. Okay, so it's not exactly word for word Peachtree Parkway overlay. Therefore, I think it's condition
22.
There it is, 22. All building elevations should comply with the requirements of the Peachtree Parkway overlay district. They have to comply with the landscapes, setbacks, architectural of the Peachtree Parkway overlay. It was just a little bit ambiguous.
Okay. So all those emails saying don't take away 13 really just didn't
it's
know that
there.
You were putting it in there somewhere
it's
else.
In there.
But I think they were a lot of them talking about the 13.
But I think it's a coincidence, but the other zoning is condition 13 too.
And it talks about square footage buildings.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
It just, yeah.
Okay.
So we've put in the Peachtree Parkway overlay and we replaced 18 with all of these conditions.
Any other discussion? We have a motion and a second. Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. New business, item one, Mr. Clark.
Jim Bryan.
Demolition options at Liberty Park.
Good evening, board. Jim Bryan, Director of Parks and Recreation. This item could be Parks and Recreation or procurement, but right now our consultant has submitted the plans and drawings to engineering for permitting for Lanier Land Park, so we don't know how long it'll take till we get that process going, but we would like to go ahead and prepare the site so there'll be no delays down the road. So we're asking for your permission to seek demolition options for the facilities on the site that we will have to demolish one day. And in doing so, we want to check out options to see if there are some there that doesn't involve us paying money for people to do it. Maybe we can get some revenue out of what's there on the site. So we're just asking right now to see if we can find some options for you.
Council, we don't need a motion for that, do we? Just Dave, go ahead and proceed.
Correct, that's right.
Mr. Crowell, I think it's an objection to proceed and find some options for us in the near land. If you would do it and bring it back to us, we'd appreciate it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Item two, John, change order for Wolverton.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, this is authorization of change order in the amount of $60,692 with Wolverton and Associates for the sidewalk design along Caney Road from Brookwood Road to Old Alpharetta Road. This is basically a modification of the existing scope of work of the Brookwood Caney Road sidewalk project. As you might recall, it was under design, but we put it on hold pending the relocation of the Brookwood intersection that was forthcoming. And then now we have the Brookwood widening project. What this does, it completes the design for the remaining section sidewalk from the intersection project down Caney Road all the way to Old Alpharetta Road and then down Old Alpharetta Road, which is a Splash 7 project. So what this does is just modify that scope of work, issue a change order to Wolverton to allow that project to move forward.
Thank you, John.
I think what he's referring to is when the fire, when we approve the fire station.
That's correct. The new intersection will be incorporated into the Brookwood Road design for the widening project, and we're in the process of getting close to update those plans. And then we'll be moving. We're moving forward with the acquisition of the right of way, and just as soon as we revise and update the plans and have the revised design and the right of way acquisition complete, we'll be letting that project to construction.
Mr. Tam, are you ready to go ahead with this project?
Sure. Mr. Chairman, thank you. I would move that we authorize the change order in the amount of $60,692 with Wolverton and Associates for the sidewalk design along Caney Creek Road from Brookwood Road to Old Alpharetta Road as presented by the Director of Engineering and is in our books tonight.
Caney Road.
Did I say Caney Creek?
Yeah.
Thank you. Caney Road.
Second.
Motion second for approval, item two. Change order. Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item three.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, this is authorization to advertise for proposed abandonment of roads located in Burnt Bridge at Setting Down Subdivision located off of Burnt Bridge Road, land lots 449 and 488 of the 3rd District, 1st Section, in Commission District 4. This was a subdivision that was platted, final platted, recorded, and accepted by the county, and the deeds were recorded. Therefore, in order for them to revert to private roads now, they would have to go through the abandonment process. Therefore, the Ethan Underwood has submitted on behalf of REO Funding Solutions this request with the appropriate documents that have been reviewed by our legal staff. And what we're asking tonight is just board authorization to move forward with the advertisement for the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second to proceed with item three. Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. John, you have one more. Item four.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Item number four is approval work authorization with Moreland Affidavit for the preliminary final engineering plans, including right-of-way plans for the McGinnis Ferry Road at Georgia 400 interchange. As you know, this project's been a long time coming. The board's recently approved a project framework agreement with GDOT for this very design. whereby 80% of these funds will be reimbursed to the county from federal dollars, and the local portion is 20%, which, as you know, you've recently had approval from, with an agreement from the Norfolk CID for $200,000 for that local portion. The amount for this design contract, based on the hourly rates provided, is $1,896,320. And it would be our recommendation that the board authorizes work authorization to Moreland Outdevelopment Associates to complete the design for this project. This is a bond project that was approved by the voters, and my understanding from Buddy Grattan is that the PFA has been routed through GDOT and been signed off by everybody. We just hadn't received it back yet. But we get this contract in place for design just as soon as GDOT gives us a notice to proceed, we tell them to go to work.
Thank you, John. Any other discussion on this?
I had a question because I know in our meetings it came up several times that McGinnis Ferry would be viewed as a regional project and that there could be ARC funding that we could receive in that. Will this getting this part accomplished put us in a better position for that?
Well, the project will be funded in state federal dollars, and we have that commitment. Now, as far as any solicitations that come out through the ARCs for additional funds that might be needed for projects, this would be one that would qualify, you know, if we chose to apply for additional funding for this project. You know, but at that point in time, we can make that decision. But right now, our bond passed with $10 million that will be budgeted for this project. And we have a commitment from GDOT, as the board knows, for the funding of the construction with state and federal dollars. Mr. Moreland is here, Buddy's here, Jason's here.
This is just for the design for the intersection.
This is for the design only of the interchange.
Okay, of the interchange.
So this gets us through the environmental right-of-way plans and final design so we can begin acquiring right-of-way.
Okay.
And this also keeps us on the books for federal dollars too, but go ahead and get the design work, correct, John?
That's correct. That secures our federal earmark. That's a good point.
$1.5 million, if I'm understanding that correctly.
That's a good point. 80% of these funds will be reimbursed to us. And as you know, we've already received some reimbursements for federal dollars for the interchange justification report that was previously done. There are some remaining federal earmark funds that are not being utilized through the design process that will be available for either right-of-way and or construction. But that does secure those earmark funds for us, and so they won't be lost.
We're worried the federal government was cutting down earmarks without on dormant projects, so we steam forward with the design of this with John's help and Mr. Moreland and Buddy to start this process. It's been a long process, but we appreciate the work y'all have done, and also work with everybody else that was involved and worried about these intersections. Y'all did a great job, and yeah. Not big about it.
Yeah, we're moving forward.
And I was wrong in if that being the interchange. I was talking more about the McGinnis Ferry widening of the road as far as future contribution regionally.
Yeah, that's
correct.
Mr. Tam, is this your district? You
thank you, Mr. Chairman. I will move that we, for approval of the work authorization with Moreland Outdevelopment for the preliminary and final engineering plans, including right-of-way plans for McGinnis Ferry Road at Georgia 400 interchange in the amount of $1,896,320 as presented by the Director of Engineering. John, I don't see a project number on here, should I? Or do I need to read one into the record? Are you comfortable?
I don't know if that's necessary.
Mr. Tam, given the agenda header, given the backup in the agenda packet, I'm very comfortable if you don't name identify them.
But I did identify that the amount that we would be working with more than enough.
Second.
Motion to second. Any other discussion? For approval item four. Please vote. Carries 5-0. Thank you, Mr. Lawson.
Thank you.
Item 5, Vanessa, please come forward. State your name.
Good evening, Board of Commissioners. I'm Vanessa Golden, Senior Planner for Forsyth County. I'm here this evening to present the Planning Commission recommendations for the short-term work program at the request of the board coming back in January. Just a refresher, the short-term work program was adopted in the fall.
Damn right. Good to see you.
For the current year. I do want to briefly review what those recommendations are. There are two projects that are currently in 2018, and these include the changes to UDC that would incorporate pedestrian-oriented design standards, as well as reviewing open space requirements and revising to maximize the utility of open space. So the recommendation was to take those projects from 2018 to drop them into the current year, 2015. And by doing that, there would be five projects that then would have to be pushed out because we allot a maximum amount of staff hours on an annual basis devoted to projects. At this point in time, the board can decide if they wish to incorporate those recommendations. There's nothing that we need to do as far as the state is concerned. We have already transmitted and adopted a current short-term work program. So if changes were made, we would not have to transmit to Georgia Mountains again. It would not have to go through a state re-review. But as a courtesy, we would inform DCA of any changes that are made. And I can answer any questions you may have.
Question from the board. We approved it earlier. This is just some changes that was warranted by the board, correct?
After review, these were the recommendations that the Planning Commission had for the Board of Commissioners, but you are correct, it's already been adopted for the current year.
Council, we just adopt these new conditions, and that's the way we proceed with this?
Well, new business item 5 simply provides that it's a discussion, but so they don't need to adopt anything on item 5.
We don't need to adopt anything.
Yeah.
Okay. Adams, thank you for the information. Any questions for the board about this change? Vanessa, item 6.
Thank you. This item is in regards to the sub-area plan that was last discussed on the December 9th work session. If you could post the sub-area map. At the last work session, I had reached out to 3 consultants and spoke in general terms of a potential scope of work and some costs that might be attached. Planning staff was then directed to draft an RFP, and what I would like to do is to review, outline the draft RFP that is currently in your books. The scope of work as currently defined for the sub-area would require an analysis of all of our existing plans. It would incorporate actual field review with the goal of identifying potential routes and connections between county facilities. And these facilities would include parks, schools, libraries, and passive recreational sites. And to connect with community nodes and neighborhoods. It would include spur trail connections to both existing and future phases of greenways, sidewalk installations, and possible support facilities that may include bicycle racks, seating areas, and restrooms. We have also requested that network alternatives for short and mid-range time periods be included in the plan until long-range facilities are constructed. And the final report would also need to address trail promotion, wayfinding, which essentially is directional signage for the route network, and would also incorporate preliminary costs, any funding opportunities, and a prioritization schedule for project implementation. In regards to what the public participation would look like, we have included in the RFP that there would be a technical steering committee, a stakeholder advisory committee, and a minimum of 2 public involvement events over and beyond the required public hearings. So that is, in essence, the outline of what is in the draft RFP. And staff is here today to see if the board is interested in moving forward. I work directly with procurement on the draft, so it is ready to go if the board so chooses.
Thank you,
Vanessa. I can answer any questions. Thank you.
Any Any questions from the board about the new sub-area plan? Do you wish approval to go ahead with RFP this, or this was for information question only?
It is up to the board. It is ready to go if the board desires for it to move forward.
I believe seeing this in Lot No District and stuff, would you like to move forward to this new sub-area plan?
I would. I think that the timing is perfect with us updating our bike head plan at the same time. They both work. I mean, it seems like this sub-area plan gave them a lot to smile about when we had our first meeting with them. So I think that the two committees there's some overlap there, wouldn't you agree?
Yes, there is.
And I want to compliment Vanessa for all the work she's put forth in this. Since tonight's theme is optimism, I've seen Vanessa more optimistic with this, having this to work on. So I will make a motion that we proceed with the sub-area plan RFP as she described.
Second for discussion. Councilor, I'm not sure, on the previous thing, I think it was said that we didn't advertise anything more than a discussion. The same is true here, yet we're voting on something.
That's right, and again, I'm taking some of my cues from Ms. Bernstein, who indicated there was no need to do anything on 5. To the extent that you're comfortable with the scope of work that was presented, I don't know that it needs to be on the agenda, that you will be taking a motion or taking an action on that. To me, this is a more formal way of the board giving direction. Mr. Monk.
Vanessa, please come back to it.
The main issue is that, of course, if it was to move forward in the RFP process, funds would have to be identified for...
And you had to bring it back to us.
Yes.
It all comes back to us.
Yes, but Donna, in essence, there currently is not an amount, nor do we know exactly where the money would be pulled from to fund the actual plan. Now, again, when I reached out to the consultants, there was quite a range of what they could offer and the price tag associated. We have tried to create a scope of work based on discussions with Commissioner Mills as well as an informal stakeholder meeting that we had, but the financial aspect of this would need to be determined at some point.
Got that. Mr. Ball. We have a motion, a second, to proceed with RFP. Council, is that all right?
It is. And before you take your vote, just to clarify, three different times this evening you've heard presentations by staff. I think two have been Ms. Bernstein, one was the Park and Rec prior to that. And again, there was not a resolution for you to look at. This one is a little closer to the extent that it is an RFP, but again, even this one will come back to you. So, Commissioner Mills, very comfortable with the motion to vote on that. I'd be comfortable without it as well, but I'm very comfortable with what y'all are doing.
We have a motion, second, to proceed. Please vote. Motion carried, 5-0. Gives us some direction, Vanessa. Item 7 has been postponed to the January 27th work session. Item 8, County Attorney Kim.
Board members, thank you very much. This is a resolution authorizing the retention and appointment of conflict counsel. As the board, I'm sure, is aware, particularly based upon the last regular meeting, we are in the business right now of condemning property, and a lot of that is based upon all of the various transportation projects that we have ongoing. You may recall some months ago, maybe it was a month, maybe a little longer, I came into you because we were condemning some property that at least a owner was Judge Bowles or Judge Bowles' family, and I felt it was better because of litigation and magistrate court that we work on that we bring in conflict counsel to handle that. This resolution that is in your agenda book this evening involves a potential or an actual condemnation that will be filed against Bobby and Maureen Bagley. They have identified themselves as the parents of Judge Jeff Bagley. And again, this is not an issue where the judge has raised this. This is an issue where I am raising it. But I think to be consistent with what I have done previously, I would feel more comfortable, board members, if you would authorize me to bring in Mr. Beck's law office to bring this condemnation. Mr. Chairman.
So move, Council.
Second.
Motion second to bring in additional counsel for condemnation proceedings. Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Number 9, Councilor.
Chairman, along that similar theme, I'm going to take it easy on y'all this evening. They're not going to make you do multiple motions to get through this. This is based upon some condemnation actions we have taken where we have named Sawney Electric Membership Corporation as a defendant in multiple condemnations. We've worked with Sawney, and we feel very comfortable that we need to resolve all of these various condemnations where we have identified them as a defendant out of abundance of caution. And Mr. Chairman, you have in your agenda packet basically proposed settlement agreements, and I'm going to read them very quickly, and then hopefully you can just make one motion, and that'll approve all the settlement agreements. There's no compensation being asserted here with respect to Sawney. We're simply allowing them out of the case, and we're all going to be able to proceed in harmony together with respect to this land acquisition that the county's involved in. But you have a settlement agreement for litigation that is identified as 14CB1309-2, 14CB1209-2, 14CB1208-3, 14CB1310-1, 14CB1432-1, 14CB1434-2, and 14CB1210-3. Mr. Chairman, it's my recommendation the board approve the settlement agreements related to each of the above civil actions I've identified.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second to approve item 9 is presented by Councilor. Resolution. Is that all right, Councilor?
Mr. Chairman, it's perfect. Thank you.
Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item 10, Councilor.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item 10 is an offshoot of last week's meeting as well, when we discussed the vegetation management permits, modifications to our sign code. The board had a spirited discussion, and the end result of that discussion was the board wanted to do one more public hearing where we would mandate that if you have a sign adjacent to Georgia 400 and you wish to secure a vegetation management permit, that the county code would allow you to reduce that billboard not to 75 feet as we had advertised, but to 50 feet. And that's my recommendation. That required one more public hearing, which we will have in February. However, in the course of that discussion, the board also got into the notion.
Council, but the public hearing was an option between 50 and 70, but not strictly go to 50, I believe.
Well, what the actual language of the ordinance said was 75 or less.
Yes. Okay.
But it made no mention of a mandatory 50 feet, and I think that's where the board wanted to go, was to bring these signs down even lower to 50 feet.
That's something to discuss. I'm just wish for discussion.
Okay.
Only.
So well, this is actually helpful then, with respect to what is going to be in front of you, because the legal ads are already running for the February public hearing. And again, I think it's germane to this agenda item that we discuss that, because they are linked. They were linked last Thursday as well. What is the board's vision for when it comes back? Is it going to be 75 feet, 50 feet, or between 75 and 50 feet?
I truly think it's going to be somewhere between. It could be 75, it could be 50, but we have an option to discuss it between the feet. Okay. I don't think we were settling on one set height yet.
The motion by Commissioner Vaughn, I thought, and again,
he did.
Well, I thought it was 50 feet, but I may have gotten ahead of y'all. That may not be where the board was landing.
We withdrew that motion to discuss it.
It's true.
That's why I thought the discussion was to be between 50 and 75, so that okay. If we settled on 75, we didn't have to have another public hearing at 50.
Well, that's right. You settled on 75, but it looked to me like you all were trying to lower them further. It was not.
I think it's just further discussion.
Okay. Well, in any event, I still feel comfortable because if the board did in fact land on lower than 75, I'm comfortable with another public hearing, but I will make sure that what comes in front of you on February gives you that flexibility.
Yes.
So if we decided we wanted to go with 75, we wouldn't have to have another public hearing?
That's correct.
Okay.
That was correct. So be that as it may, and thank you for the clarification, because that helps me to not have something on your agenda book in February that's wrong.
Yes, sir.
During that discussion, however, I think the board became concerned too that if we do go down into lowering these to 75 feet, you know, y'all may recall there was a time we weren't going to allow them or make them be lowered at all, with the notion being that candidly they're more obvious and in your face at 75 feet as opposed to 120 feet. But if we are going to have them lowered to 75 or less, I think the board was concerned about LED signs, and I think the board wanted to, while we're considering what to do, place a moratorium on LED conversions along the Georgia 400 corridor. That's what is in your agenda book this evening, would place a moratorium on an LED conversion, which, as we noted at the last regular meeting, that is an administrative process. That is not a board process. That can be done by simply filing an application to Mr. Brown's office, and it happens. And so if you adopt this resolution this evening, that will place a moratorium. So along signs on billboards on 400 that are eligible for LED conversions, they will not be able to do that for a period of 30 days from the date of the adoption of the resolution, if you adopt it this evening. Approval by the Board of Commissioners of an additional extension to the moratorium, or upon further board action if it occurs prior to 30 days. The rule in Georgia is that we can adopt what I'm calling an emergency moratorium without a public hearing. But if we want to make this longer, if we want to go to 60 days or 90 or 120 or 180, I'm going to have a public hearing under the zoning procedures law and advertise it. So this gets it done. This gives Tom Brown's office the ability to stop any further permitting of an LED conversion. But I'll need some guidance from you at your next meeting as to how whether we want to continue.
Can I ask a couple questions before I decide how I'm leaning on this? Mr. Brown, we were once talked about the brightness of the signs, and you described them as a measure of nits. And you were considering borrowing or getting a nits meter for code enforcement to check them. But we never did decide what that level would be, did we?
That work is coming to the first public hearing in February. We have multiple changes to our sign ordinance going on at the same time. One is process being managed by Ken's office regarding the lowering of these signs, and one is running through my office, which is about LED signs, which we've gone out to now identify as electronic message boards, and that public hearing number one is going to be next month.
And that's what my point, because it'd be nice to have that in place first before I make my decision on LED signs and whether they're really interfacing the matters. If they're dim enough, they're not going to blind you with water from rain reflecting off the windshield and stuff. But I think that's where I was going with it, thank you.
But what number of nits did you have in mind?
See, I don't know. We need the pros to tell us, because I don't know exactly what is too bright or not. I don't know. And of course, we may need some examples that day to show us what levels are bright and somehow show us how it reflects back on us, literally.
Are you saying when you're not in favor of a 30-day moratorium?
I am in favor until we can decide what those nits are going to be and stuff, because just personally, if it's going to be too bright, the nits are not low enough, I wouldn't want them to be LED lower down on my face. Right, but if they're going to be at a reasonable brightness, I don't mind the signs coming down and then going to the LED.
The council 30-day gives out past this first public hearing, will not?
Mr. Chairman, it will by about 2 weeks.
Can we renew the 30-day moratorium, or we have to go to a public hearing then?
I am probably going to go ahead and start the process of the public hearing just because I don't know where you're going to be, and I'd rather have it and not need it than not plan for it. So,
okay.
Thank you.
Any other questions? Do we hear a motion from the board?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we adopt the resolution enacting a limited moratorium on conversion of certain non-conforming signs to LED signs along Georgia Highway 400.
Prepared for 30 days.
Yes, Commissioner Tam, I appreciate that, but all of the limitations are in the resolution. So, thank you.
Second.
Motion second for approval item 10 resolution. Any other discussion? Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Item 11, Counselor.
Mr. Chairman, I'll be very brief, and I hope that you will find and let the record reflect that I have handed out a settlement agreement at your stations that actually contains exhibits. I think if you look in your agenda packet, that the settlement agreement in your agenda book does not contain exhibits A and B. This pertains, Mr. Chairman, to litigation the Board of Commissioners authorized my office to bring to vindicate the county's interest in a surety maintenance bond and a performance bond with respect to Platte River Insurance Company. Based upon candidly some excellent work by the engineering department and some of the folks there that have worked with representatives of Plat River and the surety, we have an agreement that I think is satisfactory to the county that makes sure that the work in this subdivision is done. You will see that on Exhibit A and Exhibit B. This has been looked at by engineering staff even as of today, and they are comfortable that this is a good deal that addresses litigation, shuts down litigation, otherwise makes sure that subdivision is brought up to where it needs to be. Mr. Chairman, I can recommend approval this evening.
Thank you, Counselor. Salute.
Second.
Any other discussion about settlement resolution? Settlement agreement? Please vote. Motion carries 5-0. Counselor, I know you said there were, but we have to go through this. Is there a need for executive session to discuss litigation, land acquisition, and our personnel?
Mr. Chairman, there is, and pursuant to motion and vote, when we come out of executive session, we will come back out into the open session and will very likely take action with respect to an agreement that has been discussed in executive session.
And I will recuse myself from executive session and, I guess, to vote at the end of the meeting on this matter.
You will not recuse yourself from the entirety of the executive session. There are going to be some items we discussed that are not, you are not, have to be recused from. So you have to bear with us, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry.
I had some ownership to stay.
Do I have a motion to enter the executive session at 6:05?
Second. For the purposes of land acquisition litigation.
This land acquisition litigation, I'll work now. Please vote.
Tisdale.
Hello.
Would you like this?
Commissioner, can I ask you a question about the...
No.
Okay. Ask that guy there. He handles all my questions for me.
He always tells me you can't say anything because it's under litigation.
That's right.
Agreement between Forsyth County, and I'm not going to read all of the names, but it is the Mashburns generally that are involved in the Lindy versus Mashburn lawsuit. I've discussed all of the terms and components of the agreement to you previously. I'm simply seeking a motion at this point for the board to ratify saying. So moved.
Second.
All in favor, please vote, or I'll vote.
Thank you.
4-0 with Commissioner Amos. Chairman Amos recusing. Is there any other business to come before the board?
Motion to adjourn. Second.
All vote. Meeting adjourned, 6:58.
Anybody see Pittsburgh?
Where do you see that?
See you next time.
I wrote a letter to Wolverton like a year ago when they originally, you guys originally threw funding for the design standards, encouraging them to be creative and not just, some 4-foot sidewalk without any meeting or anything else.